I'm now convinced that consciousness can be experienced without the body, in the period of a non-functioning brain, which means that death is just the end of our physical aspects, just the end of our body, but not the end of our consciousness. There is a continuity of consciousness after the death of our body.
Dr. van Lommel, you are a cardiologist and one of the most internationally renowned death researchers. Among other things, you have published a highly regarded study that deals with near-death experiences of people who were demonstrably considered clinically dead and were resuscitated. I would like to talk to you today about the current status of your research, but I would like to start with a personal question. What originally led you to study near-death experiences? Was there a patient with a particular story that impressed you?
So the first time I ever heard about a near-death experience, it was before Raymond Moody has written his book, Life After Life. It was in 1969. I was just starting my specialization in cardiology in one of the first coronary care units in the Netherlands, because modern resuscitation techniques became possible. The shock, defibrillation, and external chest compression were possible. So I was working in one of the first coronary care units in the Netherlands, and then we had a 44-year-old man who had a cardiac arrest. We resuscitated, we had three or four shocks. He regained consciousness, and we as a team were very happy. I was the doctor in charge. But the patient was extremely disappointed and told me about a tunnel and a light and a landscape and beautiful music, etc. And I have never forgotten this event, but I did never anything to do with it, because I had we had a young family, two young children, we were starting with specialization, etc.
The patient spoke about it completely freely.
But it was totally impossible that people should have a memory from a period of unconsciousness. So when I got a book in 1986 by George Ritchie, Return from Tomorrow, about his near-death experience as a medical student in 1943. He died of a double pneumonia, and there were no antibiotics available, so he died. And his body was covered with a sheet. And a nurse was so upset that this young medical student died that he was able to persuade the doctor to give him an injection with adrenaline right into his heart. It was totally uncommon in 43. But he, after a period of death of 9 minutes, he came back and had a very, very deep near-death experience with all the aspects we know.
Can you tell us a bit about what he experienced?
I had all what you can imagine. Had, let's say he was aware of being dead. He had an experience of a tunnel, going to the light, met deceased relatives, had an out-of-body experience. Not only that he saw his own body, but he was hundreds of thousands of miles away in a place where he was in a bar and sort of things were happening. And many times later he went to the place because he couldn't believe that he has been there, but he was there exactly how he had seen it in his near-death experience. He became in a very dark space where people were fighting, etc., the kind of hellish experience, but he saw that each being who was there had a light being above. At the moment, they were able to be aware that there was a light being for help, then they could leave. So even this aspect he had as well. And he regained consciousness, he had a problem to find his body back because the body was covered with a sheet, but he saw his fraternity ring from his student organization. And then they said, oh, I have to put that in here. That was the moment I started to ask patients who survived a cardiac arrest in the past if they could have memories from the period of unconsciousness, the period of cardiac arrest. And from 86 to 88, in 2 years, out of 50 patients who survived cardiac arrest, 12 patients shared their NDE with me. Mm-hmm. It was very impressive and very emotional, also for me.
And then, as a doctor, you were probably always very open, which is probably why the patients spoke to you.
I think the people with an NDE feel that you're open. Mm-hmm. They have an inner knowing as well. Mm-hmm. But then started with me the scientific curiosity, because I had learned on university, I had learned in the medical school, that consciousness is a product of brain function. So it should be impossible that patients can have memories from a period of unconsciousness, let alone an enhanced consciousness with the period of with the possibility of perception out and above the lifeless body, with cognition, with emotions, with memories from early childhood. It should be impossible. Mm. So that's why we started the prospective study, to see if we could have an explanation for the cause and content of the near-death experience. Mm-hmm. Until that time, there were only retrospective studies done with a selection of patients, and people thought that it was just this experience were due to hallucinations, activity in the brain, neurotransmitters, anoxia of the brain, dreams, whatever.
I think in the earlier studies, the medical histories of the described patients were not always clear either.
May you have a story about 10 years or 20 years before, you don't know exactly what had happened. So that was the reason. It started with scientific curiosity, because it was impossible that what people told me. That's why we started in 1988 our prospective study in a total of 344 consecutive patients who survived a cardiac arrest in 10 Dutch hospitals. Mm-hmm. That's how it started.
Yeah.
and only later, when I started to interview patients, I read about the book from Raymond Moody, Life After Life. So I wasn't aware of this. At all.
Wie oft würden Sie heute sagen, kommen Nahtoderfahrungen vor?
Ist das How often do near-death experiences occur? Do you have any current estimates?
So let's say in our prospective study in cardiac arrest patients with a mean age of 62 years old, 18% reported a near-death experience. But there has been one study done in very young children who nearly died in coma, trauma, traffic accident, near drowning, etc., encephalitis. That has 70% of those children had an NDE, so a higher percentage than in our study with older patients. And retrospective studies, usually between 30 and 40 years old, with people who have a traffic accident, about 30 to 40% of people tell the report a near-death experience. So the older they are, the less frequent the near-death experience is reported. But we know from studies, inquiries in Germany and the USA, that about 4% of the people in the Western world should have had a near-death experience, which is 20 million, 25 million people in Europe, 4 million people in Germany. But more than 10 to 50 million people in the United States. Mm-hmm. So it happens quite often. The problem is, usually they don't share it with others. I have known patients who had been silent for their death experience for 50 years, because nobody will believe them as well.
Sie haben's jetzt ja schon selbst angesprochen.
We already sat across from each other once, about 10 years ago, back then in your home country, the Netherlands. And you summarized your research by saying that something you learned as a medical student needs to be reconsidered, namely that the brain produces consciousness. This is because people can obviously experience consciousness even if their brain functions have failed or are severely impaired. Has there been any change to this central statement up to now?
I'm sure now, because not only because of our study, but also the same kind of study design has been done by Bruce Gracie in the USA and about Sampani and Peter Fennick in the UK and Penny Sartori in the UK about a total of 562 survivors of cardiac arrest had this about 15 to 20% of those patients had a near-death experience. And in all these studies, we could exclude scientific explanation. Mm-hmm. That means we could exclude that anoxia of the brain, lack of oxygen in the brain, could be an explanation, because if they when we compared the 18% of patients who had a near-death experience with the 82% of patients with no memory at all, when we compared the two groups, before the duration of cardiac arrest, if it was 2 minutes or 8 minutes, didn't matter at all. Mm-hmm. If they had 5 minutes of unconsciousness or 3 weeks in coma, didn't matter at all. If they had complicated CPR with the need of intubation, etc., a lot of medication, didn't matter at all. Mm-hmm. We had 30 patients in the cath lab with electrophysiological studies, and they usually are resuscitated within 30 seconds, didn't matter at all. Mm-hmm. They give a medication, didn't matter at all. Fear of death, a psychological explanation, didn't matter at all. Foreknowledge that you know that these experiences are possible, didn't matter at all. Gender didn't matter at all. Mm-hmm. Religion, if they were atheist or Christian or Muslim, didn't matter at all. So we could exclude in our study for the first time all until that time given possible explanations for the cause of the NDE. Mm-hmm.
Jetzt gibt es ja in der Medizin unzählige Belege.
There is countless evidence of a connection between brain activity and consciousness. For example, dementia. If the brain does not produce consciousness, what does it do?
Yeah. Let's first tell us that we know from patients with cardiac arrest, what we call clinical death, there have been studies done with patients with induced cardiac arrest, for instance, for threshold testing internal defibrillators. Mm-hmm. Also, induced cardiac arrest in animals. What we see when you induce a cardiac arrest, within seconds, patients lose consciousness. Mm-hmm. They're unconscious. They lose the body reflexes, which is a function of the cortex of the brain. They lose the brainstem reflexes, the gag reflex. You put a finger in someone's throat. The corneal reflexes. And fixed dilated pupils are clinical findings in those patients. The breathing stops. The breathing center is close to the brainstem. And we have, in their studies, had measurement of the activity of the cortex. The EEG has been done. And between 10 and 20 seconds, there's always a flatline EEG. And we know from all the studies, when you have a cardiac arrest, you will never have a successful CPR within 20 seconds. It always two, three, four minutes. So all 562 patients in the four prospective studies in survivors of cardiac arrest must have had a flatline EEG, and then still 20% had a near-death experience. So a period of enhanced consciousness with a period of the possibility of perception out and above the lifeless body, mm-hmm. cognition, emotions, memories, etc. So this, we have to discuss again the never proven hypothesis that consciousness is a product of brain function, because we have proven that the brain doesn't function at all in cardiac arrest after 10 to 20 seconds. And we know from out-of-body experience that the consciousness is out of the body also after 3 or 4 minutes, or is out of the body in different places, or you can walk through the walls in the hospital, you see your family member somewhere else in the hospital, so you can perceive from above and also structures as well. It proves that consciousness can be experienced when the brain does not function at all.
So in your opinion, what does the brain do in relation to consciousness?
For me, so this consciousness that people tell us about in death experience, it's a different consciousness than we have, it's our waking consciousness, where we're mm-hmm. sitting here. Our waking consciousness is just a small part of this enhanced of non-local consciousness. People tell us, also especially in the life review, that everything happens at the same moment. The past, the future events, there's no time, there's no space. The moment you think of something or somebody, you will be there, you will meet him. Mm-hmm. So this different kind of consciousness, where everything is always connected at the same time, is an experience of oneness. Mm-hmm. Experience of unconditional love, experience of extreme wisdom and insight as well. Well, that's not what we have when we're here in our body. Mm-hmm. So the brain functions as an interface or as a filter or transceiver. So it receives just a small part of this non-local consciousness into our body as our waking consciousness. And it sends information from our senses and body to this consciousness. And I always try to explain it by the modern worldwide communication. So at this very moment, there are 200,000-300,000 phone calls going through you and through me and through these walls. There are hundreds of radio and television programs going through us. Mm. And 1 billion websites and YouTube, also your films, are now going through us as electromagnetic informational fields. And you need a functional instrument to receive it. Mm-hmm. So the cloud with all those websites and YouTube films is always there, always here. And you need a functional computer to receive, depending on what you code, it's mm-hmm. coding, you can receive it in your computer. But your computer does not produce it, mm-hmm. it receives it. And when your computer is off, the information is always there. Mm-hmm. When your brain is off, your consciousness is always there. So I compare the cloud a little bit like the non-local consciousness. It is everywhere, always available, but you need a functional brain to receive it into mm-hmm. your body. Mm-hmm.
I would like to address a few critical objections that have recently been used to question the authenticity of near-death experiences. These include the assumption that there could still be residual activity in the brain for a long time after a cardiac arrest, which would then also play a role in near-death experiences.
Könnte es ja sein, meinen Menschen, dass doch im Gehirn irgendwelche Aktivitäten bestehen.
Even a flat EEG would not prove that there is no residual activity in the brain.
I don't believe it, because you talk about non-perceivable activities. What we can measure in the brain is neural correlates of consciousness. Mm-hmm. So you can meet activity in the brain by EEG, that's electromagnetic activity, you can mean magnetic activity, and MEG, you can measure blood flow by the fMRI, you can meet chemical activity by the PET scan. Mm-hmm. But these are all neural correlates of consciousness. You meet activities in the brain, but you cannot measure consciousness. Mm-hmm. And we don't know if consciousness is the result of the cause of this activity. But when there is no activity at all, when we don't can measure activity, we know from to have this waking consciousness, you need many neural centers in the brain who exchange information mm-hmm. and communicate with each other. The global neural workspace. That's what we see in modern neurophysiology, mm-hmm. to have the necessity to have waking consciousness. And there's no such activity at all mm-hmm. when you have a cardiac arrest. Mm-hmm. And also, in animal studies, we've seen when we induce cardiac arrest in animals that there is no activity in the brainstem and the deeper structures of the brain as well, that stops functioning as well.
Mm-hmm. Ein anderer Einwand, wir wissen heute ja, dass das Gehirn.
We know that our brain constructs memories, meaning it draws a seemingly coherent overall picture from fragments. But memories often do not correspond to reality. Now, you could argue, during the near-death experience, brain functions may have been reduced or failed. But at the time when someone talks about it, their brain is functioning. And then it could also reconstruct the near-death experiences in order to process any fragments of impressions. What do you think about this?
Well, that's nonsense, because we know exactly what the people tell us that they have seen, and we can corroborate, let's say for out-of-body experience, we can mm-hmm. corroborate theoretical perceptions, and we can ask doctors and nurses or family members for what happened during the CPR, what happened during the traffic accident, and we can, and there has been recently a book, The Self Does Not Die, mm-hmm. published with 128 cases of corroborated theoretical perceptions from out-of-body experiences. And this proves that what they tell us, what happened during cardiac arrest, what happens during coma, what happens during surgery, really happened in 98% of their memories were totally correct, mm-hmm. and which proves that it's correct. And as always in a study done in Belgium about memories, where you have memories from near-death experience, it's much better memory than you have from normal things that happens mm-hmm. in your life. Mm-hmm. So it's a different kind. Your memories are even better what happened to you, what in your consciousness during cardiac arrest, during a near-death experience.
Why do you think so little has come out of the AWARE studies?
Well, there were 58 patients who survived cardiac arrest, and 28, they could have an interview with them. And then two of them had a near-death experience, and there were no really objective, let's say, out-of-body experiences that they really could objectify as well. Mm. I don't know why. I think it's more and more difficult, and the rest study is always done to see if there's still activity in the brain by EEG, and they have tried to with hidden signs somewhere in the, near the bottom, near the ceiling of the resuscitation room. Never happened. They saw something. Also in our study, we didn't have perception of hidden signs somewhere above, close to the ceiling. And they also ask, well, for us as a skeptic scientist, I want to have proof. I want to know patients who see this hidden sign from above. And then the discussion is, the terminology is that you have a blindness because you are distracted. Mm-hmm. May you drive a car and you look at your iPhone or your mm-hmm. smartphone, there are many more accidents, and they mm-hmm. say, well, I didn't see the car coming. Mm-hmm. There have been studies done with a film with them, basketball players, and the students must look at the two groups are playing basketball, and they're telling, etc. And then they didn't see the gorilla who were walking by. So inattentional blindness, it is mm-hmm. called. And there are many studies done. When you're out of your body, you see your own CPR, your own surgery. You don't start to look around if there's someone hidden sign. Mm. You're totally overwhelmed by the fact that it is possible that you see your own lifeless body. So it's the inattentional blindness which could explain that this kind of studies doesn't work. But Sampani did also EEG studies, but they start CPR, and then after 5 minutes the team from Sampani comes with two or three things putting on the head, and then so it's not that easy at all. The practical aspects of this kind of studies are very, very difficult.
It is often said that the most convincing proof of the authenticity of a near-death experience is how fundamentally people change after an NDE. In this context, I would like to come back to your study. You scientifically monitored the further personal development of patients who were clinically dead and had an NDE, and compared them with patients who were also clinically dead but did not have an NDE. What differences were there?
That is an important question we had as well. So we did not only a prospective study, which took 2 years, but also a longitudinal study with interviews after 2 years and 8 years of all patients with an NDE who still survived, with a matched control group of patients who survived cardiac arrest. Mm-hmm. Matched control group is the same gender, the same age, and the same time interval. Mm-hmm.
But no near-death experience.
No near-death experience. Mm-hmm. To see if there could be a difference in transformation. And the classical transformation we know from a near-death experience is, first of all, they lose the fear of death. Mm-hmm. They're convinced that there's continuity of consciousness. Second is a new insight of what is important in life, which is this unconditional love, empathy, and compassion towards yourself. Accept your own negative aspects we all have. And then empathy, unconditional love, compassion towards others, towards nature, towards the planet Earth, because they are all connected. They still feel connected, they still experience of oneness. And the third aspect is enhanced intuitive sensitivity, so they know what other people think and feel. And what we found out that only patients with the NDE had this classical transformation. people without an NDE also transformed a bit, but not in the same way. And let's say the interest in spirituality especially became after an NDE. Mm-hmm. So they changed the way they lived. The problem, although, is that when you have an NDE, you're overwhelmed by this experience because it doesn't fix in your own worldview you had. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of doctors who had an NDE that said, what happened to me, I always said, is impossible. But now it happens to you. And then you try to share it with others. Nobody will listen. Doctors are very bad in it. Nurses are better. Even, and then family members and partners. The divorce rate is more than 70% because the partner said it's not the same person as was before his experience. So they changed a lot. But first of all, they don't know what happened to them. They don't have a name for their experience. They think they are crazy. They cannot share it with others. So a period of depression, loneliness, and homesickness, which can take years. So it is spiritual trauma. It's hard work until they read a book, see a program on television, whatever, and they say, oh, I'm not crazy, I'm not the only one. And then they start to read about it and to speak to perhaps to other people with an NDE as well. So then they start to accept their experience. And the second is to integrate experience into their life, so they change the way they live. It's not about money, it's not about power, it's not about young life, young body, it's not about clothes, it's about the essence of who we are. Mm. And this change is not easy in the Western society as well, in this materialistic society as well. So the change is huge and it takes a long time and effort to integrate this experience into the personal daily life. So what I told you before, I know patients who had been silent for 50 years. We once did a study in Holland in 82 patients who had a near-death experience with a mean interval of 24 years, between 7 months and 70 years. Mean interval of 24 years. Still half of them with the mean interval was not able to talk about their experience with others. So it's a trauma. Hmm. They're lonely, depressed. So it's not easy at all to have this, despite a positive content mostly. It's hard work to get it accepted and integrated. Mm-hmm.
Sie haben es auch schon erwähnt.
Not everyone experiences a near-death experience under comparable circumstances. Rather, only a relatively small percentage does. Why is that the case? Or could it be that everyone experiences something, but not everyone can remember it?
Yeah. Two things, two different questions. I think. But I told you before, when they did a prospective study in children, 70% of those children had a near-death experience. Under the age of 5, children are open, are constantly connected with this enhanced consciousness. But they lose this because of education, because of the parents, because of the Western society. And the older you are, the connection between consciousness and the brain is more strict. So the older you are, it takes more time to get out of your body. And when you have a cardiac arrest, you need 5 to 10 minutes to get out, and it needs more time. In our study, we compared a patient under the age of 60 and over the age of, under the age of 60, more patients had an NDE than the older. So what I say, everybody who dies will have a death experience, but perhaps they need 30 minutes or 20 minutes, and not 5 minutes to get out of the body. Everybody will have a death experience, what we know from after-death communication. So in Europe, 125 million people had an after-death communication. It proves that consciousness is still there, and they can tell us what happens to them when they left the body. So they have had a death experience, but a near-death experience depends a little bit of the situation, and especially also the age. It's a speculation, I cannot prove it, but I think it should be true.
Gehen wir jetzt einmal aufgrund all Ihrer Erlebnisse, Forschungsergebnisse davon aus.
Let's assume that near-death experiences are real, not imaginary, not hallucinations, but real experiences. What does this mean for consciousness research? What is consciousness if not a product of the brain?
There's no definition of consciousness. We can just describe it, we can talk about it, but there's no clear, good definition. So for science, it's just a challenge to talk about consciousness, and especially the mind-brain relationship. So I'm now convinced that consciousness can be experienced without a body, in the period of a non-functioning brain, which means that death is just the end of our physical aspects, just the end of our body, but not the end of our consciousness. There is a continuity of consciousness after the death of our body. So consciousness has always been there before birth and after death. There's no beginning, nor will there ever be an end to consciousness. And consciousness is always interconnected instantaneously with the past and with the future as well. So it's a different kind of consciousness. And when you asked before about people with dementia or Alzheimer, then the instrument, the brain, has been damaged. The waking consciousness is damaged. Your computer is damaged, so you cannot get all the websites you want to have. But the non-local consciousness, the real consciousness, can never be damaged because it's not dependent of the brain. Internet, the cloud, is not dependent of your computer.
Sie sprechen eben vom endlosen Bewusstsein.
Your book is entitled Consciousness Beyond Life.
Welche Erfahrung haben Sie denn mit diesem Begriff gemacht?
What experience have you had with this definition of consciousness?
Kreisen aus Ihrer Sicht eine gewisse Akzeptanz inzwischen dafür?
Is there a certain acceptance of it in scientific or medical circles?
I started in 86, so that is now 8 years ago. And it has changed, I think, especially the younger generation. It's much more open. I got the invitation from medical students, they are open, nurses are open, psychology students. I've been lecturing in universities all over Europe, Germany, Belgium, Netherlands, UK, Yale University, USA, etc. The younger generation is open. They're much more aware also about, when we talk about the climate change, the younger generation is much more open. They are aware of what is happening. They're more feeling close to the environment as well. So they're more open to each other as well. And when you have a parent who has a near-death experience or has an enhanced intuition, the children will keep this enhanced intuition and not lose it. So the more adults have a near-death experience or after-death communication, the more children will keep this enhanced. They are not lost when they become the age of 6 or 7.
Die Aussicht, dass es Bewusstsein geben kann, dass Bewusstsein erlebbar ist, auch wenn es kein Gehirn mehr gibt.
If we assume that consciousness also functions without a brain, without a body, does that mean that there is life after death?
I never talk about life after death.
Okay.
Because life is a biological system. And there's no biological system anymore because your body has died. I talk about the continuity of consciousness. It's different. So I don't talk about life after death. I want to be strict. Scientific terminology.
Consciousness continues to exist, including the I, the ego.
The ego is just dependent of your body, about of your waking consciousness. The self, which is a higher self with a capital, is always there. It's in a non-local realm. And perhaps the self is even a light being. Your higher self is a light being up there. But the ego, with all the physical things you want to have, you want to, sexual, whatever, that disappears. Then you have no body anymore. Then you have the self, which is different.
I started with a personal question and I would like to end with one. How do you view death today? Calmly, curious, full of expectation?
Yeah, I'm curious. Positive curious, not about this process of dying, that can be very hard work, but I'm curious what will happen afterwards, and I'm about quite sure what will happen. Mm. Never 100%.
Thank you very much for the interview.
You're welcome.